Well, you look tired. Have a seat. Some of you have been running half marathons. You've been biking into Balloon Park. You've been watching the colors, and we're so glad to have you. As you can tell, I'm in the spirit. I've got my most colorful outfit on in honor of the balloons. Wherever you are in celebrating the balloons today, we're glad that you're here. It's been a fun weekend so far. So if you're a guest, we want you to feel especially welcome, because we are a group of people that simply are following Jesus. That's what we're about. And so we welcome you into that journey. And today you get to show up on a start of a brand new sermon series, a series called Pocket Siren on Technology. And I thought, in honor of talking about technology with the new iPhone coming out, that I should show you this commercial. And it's maybe one that you haven't seen. It's shot in a way that's got two chromes here, two textures, so it saves a lot of download speed. But take a look at this new body style on the new iPhone.
This is Washington, D.C. Somewhere in this city is the headquarters of a top secret organization known as Control. Its business is counterespionage. This is Symphony Hall in Washington. Somewhere in this audience is one of Control's top employees, a man who lives a life of danger and intrigue, a man who's been carefully trained never to disclose the fact that he is a secret agent.
Smart, Agent 86. Hello, Chief. Max. What's up? Chaos, eh? Yes, sir? I'll be right over. I may be a few minutes late, Chief.
This is the pilot episode from 1965, way before my birth, of the show Get Smart. And you just saw Maxwell Smart, who's kind of like James Bond meets Steve Carell. In fact, Steve Carell played this in the reboot in 2008. Now, what's crazy is 50, 60 years ago, no one could imagine a phone ringing anywhere except in a telephone booth, or in a house, or in a place of business. Certainly not in a symphony orchestra, but yet we are totally used to it. Get Smart actually predicts for us what a smartphone is, right? And to start off, I just want us to think about the influence of what that's meant, where even homeless people now have cell phones. And for multiple decade after decade, we're able to connect not only to whoever we want to via phone or text, but to the internet, to find the answer to any question at all. In fact, I could ask you a question, you could Google it right now and get the answer in a matter of seconds. And so I ask you, because you're able to do this, because you're able to get those answers, do you feel more happy? Do you feel more connected to other people? Do you feel a sense of mental and physical well-being and health? In some ways, some of the answers to life's most difficult questions just can't be Googled. They can't be answered. And so this series, we're going to look very closely at technology. We're going to invite God into the conversation as we think about how we use technology of all kinds. And whenever I face questions that I can't answer, a lot of times it's music or movies or the arts that helps. And there's been a song that's been stuck in my mind for some time that I want to share with you today. It's a song that's kind of confusing. In fact, I'd invite you to turn in your Bibles to Psalm 85. And what's confusing to me about this particular psalm is, first, it seems like it starts out talking about what God has done in the past tense to get me out of trouble. Have you ever been in trouble? where you've done something wrong, you're embarrassed by it, you're begging God's forgiveness, you've done this terrible thing, and God seems to invite you back. Well, it seems like everything's in the past tense. And then suddenly, it shifts into the present tense where they're asking God to help out. Okay, so which is it? I'm confused. Did God help you? Or are you needing God to help you right now? It's kind of like a country song. You know, I did you wrong. Thanks for taking me back. Would you please take me back again? I'm lost. I'm a little bit confused and wondering what to do. It makes me think about Herlinda. When I talk with Herlinda, she was trying to put to rest old Herlinda. She was trying to change everything about her life. She was no longer using. She was no longer dealing. She had gotten a job. And yet, all these things that she did to come back to God, even becoming a Christian, being baptized, committing her life to Christ, all the stuff just was still there. She wondered, is God angry with her? The fact that she still was divorced, that she lost the custody battle for her kids, that her apartment had no furniture in it at all, is God angry? I mean, her question is the psalmist's question, and it's also our question today. Let's take a look. Let me read to you these words that I let you sit down for today, starting in verse 1. Lord, you were favorable to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people. You pardoned all their sin. You withdrew your wrath and you turned from your hot anger. All that's past tense, right? Watch this, verse 4. Restore us again, O God, of our salvation, and put away your indignation towards us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again so that your people may rejoice with you? Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant to us your salvation. Did you see it? Did you notice it? Did you see that transition? This psalm is kind of like a we've got spirit, yes we do, we've got spirit, how about you kind of psalm. There's a call and response to it. So I'm going to do something here. I'm going to split right down the middle here. All of you people on the right, I'm going to get you to say something with me, all right, from verse 5. And we'll say it. I'll tell you what it is. You repeat it. And then everybody over here, I'm going to give you something to say as well. God, will you be angry with us forever? Okay, that was pretty good, but you sounded asleep. So one more time. God, thank you. That's much better. Appreciate it. Okay, over here, verse 6, all right? Give us life, O God.
Give us life, O God.
You guys are much more energetic. It's very good. And then together in verse 7, all of us will say, God, show us some love already. Very, very good. That's well done. That's what this song is kind of about. Except there's one more problem. It's not just the confusion of, well, did God get us out of the mess? Or do we need God to get us out of the current mess? It's something else. This is a song of Korah. Who? Korah? Are you kidding me? Korah? A son of Korah? What is that doing in there? I mean, it would be no less shocking if it said Psalm of Lady Gaga. Psalm of Post Malone. This is the song of a bad boy, and no offense against Lady Gaga, Post Malone, or anybody. I'm not judging them there. But you're shocked because what are they doing in here? Well, let me tell you the story of Korah. You might not know, but there's lots of priestly rivalry. And in Numbers 16, Moses was the appointed leader by God. Aaron was the priest. But there are lots of other rival groups. And Korah, he kind of decided that he didn't like that Moses had appointed himself as priestly leader or as kingly leader. And that Aaron would be the only priest. Are you kidding me? And so he comes to challenge the authority of both Moses and Aaron. And so Moses, what he does immediately whenever Korah comes with these 250 men is he falls down flat on his face before God, before all these people, and he says, God will make known who is his. God will make known who is holy. Now, I find this really interesting that Moses didn't whip out the PowerPoint display and say, okay, This is why my leadership is superior to that of Korah. Let me rationally argue with you. No. He falls down before God and says, God will decide. So here's what they do. They get their sensors out. Now, a sensor is kind of like a smartphone. No, it's not like a smartphone at all. It's a torch. It's a stick with coals on the end of it and incense. And all these 250 men are to stand out in front of their tents. And God is going to show in this kind of Old West priestly duel who is the winner by who dies an unnatural death. Oh, okay. It really is an Old West shootout. Who dies an unnatural death? Someone's going to die here. Well, Korah gang, they're on this side over here. Moses says, hey, everybody get away from Korah. And what happens is the ground opens up, swallows up Korah. Hot lava fire burns all of the 250 men remaining. The rest of Israel take off. They are running like you would from a natural disaster. Now, the family of Korah are not going to be able to go to their life insurance agent and say, well, they died by natural causes. We need to collect this claim. I'm sorry, but being burned by your sensors and being swallowed by an earthquake is not natural causes. They failed the test. They died unnaturally. And all that's left is their shiny bronze melted sensors. Here's the problem. What Korah wanted was power without holiness. He wanted to have leadership and control without a life that's devoted to God. Now, this is the first thing that I want you to catch with technology. We want the power to be able to shop and handle our finances and control many, many things, but we may not seek the holiness that such powers demand. They became holy. They became holy at the cost of their very lives. In fact, that melted down bronze sensors, do you know what happened to them? They were hammered onto the altar of God as a memory. Okay, now wait a second, Brady, you got me distracted here. Why is a hymn by Korah sons in the book? I mean, if I'm a worship leader, if I'm a minister, I'm like, okay, as soon as the smoke clears, let's get that psalm out of the hymn book. Let's not sing that one anymore. I mean, that guy's a bad guy. So why is it there? How did it even show up at all if there's no one left? Well, evidently, some sons of Korah did survive in Numbers 26, verse 10. And the fact that they wore the name and didn't change their name meant that something had been learned from that. There's about a dozen psalms of Korah that are in Scripture. And this one, maybe more so than any, really shows that they have learned this very important lesson. A lesson where, remember I said, we've got spirit? Yes, we do. We've got spirit. How about you? Where we left off with this psalm was, God, show us some love already. Can you say that again to me? God, show us some love already. Because we're frozen in time. In verse 8, this is what happens. The priest stepped forward to say, let me hear what God the Lord will speak. And then it's silent. It gets really awkwardly silent. The kind of silence where the kids start looking around and everyone's phones are off. And they wonder, did someone tear an ACL on the field? Did the priest kneel down and rip the inside or the outside of the ACL? Is that right, Jason? Yeah. I mean, what happened? Why is everyone so quiet? And it's because they're listening. You know, I don't know about you, but life is so noisy. I'm not listening. There's no space. When's the last time the television was off? When did you take the earbuds out, leave the stereo off in the car? Do you remember a time sitting and waiting on the kids or waiting in the doctor's office when you were not looking at your phone? There's no space. We're busy. We're talking. We're multitasking, and we don't mute the noise that is in our life. We're like crack addicts waiting for our next fix, like a stockbroker who just needs one more quote, or like a parent that just has one more thing to get done. And in this silence, I feel my brain being rewired, and you probably do. I've felt it for decades. I remember many years ago leading a meeting, and some of the people of a group of about 20 were in the room, and others were not. And there was a guy I was calling iPhone John because he was joining on a conference call. And then suddenly John just kind of stopped talking, and we realized my assistant's phone was dead. He was gone. And I said, well, just here, use my phone and call him. And she's like, I don't know his number. And I didn't realize it, but I knew him as well, but I didn't have his number. None of us had memorized his number. Now, I know you have all of your phone numbers memorized. Our convenience has allowed us to offload a bunch of data elsewhere, and our lives have changed. With social media, how we interact with another has changed. We don't have to be tired of a friend anymore and have to face them and say, you know, this friendship is over. We just unfriend them. We delete them. Or maybe there's someone we don't want in our life. We can friend them. We can hide them. We can put them in a circle and not put them in our viewable friends, right? In fact, we don't have to have physical presence at all with any of our friends if we don't want to. If I choose to look, I can. If I don't want to, I don't have to. Now, I am not anti-technology. If you followed me around, you would know that. I have all the stuff. In fact, I'm usually an early adopter on almost everything. And this will not be a series that's anti-technology, but it's helping us look at technology with God. Sherry Turkle wrote a book many years ago called Alone Together. Sherry's an MIT researcher, and she said, why we care more about our technology and invest less in our friends. She said that in 1985, she quotes some statistics, we had three people in our lives that we could ask about a big decision, that we could really trust. And 20 years later, that was down to two. I don't know what that number is now, but she drew attention that the other number that had increased is that 25% of people said they had no one that they could talk with about a difficult decision that's in their lives. This is tough. When all of our lives are mediated, when we send thousands of text messages, maybe even to people in our own house, Don and I have done it even today at church, not communicating face-to-face, but doing it indirectly. Oh, wait, Brady, you got distracted again from the psalm. We have that priest standing there saying, let me hear what God the Lord will speak. What happened? We got distracted. Well, that listening to me, that moment in the psalm, right in the middle of verse 8, is proof that Korah's ancestors, his descendants, got the message. They got the message that the first step is not to be active, not to be seeking our own power, but to step back and ask God to listen. That first step is silence, to seek the one leader that matters, the only one, not some preacher, not some worship leader, not some elder or other leader of the church, not some new innovation, but to seek God and listen to God. Look again with me in verse 8. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak. He will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land again. Peace. That's what I want. How about you? A sense of calmness and wholeness, a sense of shalom. That's what I want. And yet, even now, my brain won't let me. I've got emails to answer. I've got things to do. I've got calls to return. Sitting still is not an option for me. And how is it that we're supposed to unplug from this world in which we're so carefully plugged into? All right, it's time for some audience participation. How many of you, by a show of hands, read your Bible every day? No reason to lie here, but by every day, I mean like 5 days a week. Very good. Put your hands down. How many of you pray every day? And by every day, I mean every day. Okay, good. How many of you would be willing to try a new spiritual discipline? A discipline that's not prayer, it's not Bible reading. Would you be willing to? If you would like to try a new spiritual discipline, then stand up on your feet. Okay, we've got a few takers, All right, here's the spiritual discipline. Instead of prayer, instead of Bible reading, what I want you to do is power off your phone and leave it off and leave it at home for 24 hours. If you're willing to do that, please remain standing. Otherwise, sit down. If you will do this for 24 hours, oh, a lot of people sitting down, a lot of brave people still standing, and a lot of people who never stood up at all. That's okay. No judgment here. All of you can sit down. I want you to just think about that.
You probably are twitching right now, just imagining. Well, wait, Brady, I have this, 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 and this. I heard a lot even in between the two services about what needs to happen. But isn't that interesting? We've got spiritual disciplines that we will do, but if we touch on maybe something that's even more vital to our life, we're afraid to let go of it. There's a drought in our land. It's almost as if God is an app on our phone that we've forgotten about. You probably don't have any of those. Unused apps, deleted apps. We downloaded it, we bought it, but yet we don't use God. We don't connect with God. And that drought is a drought for the land. We know what droughts are like here. We don't get a lot of rain in the high desert. It just doesn't happen. And yet, are we affected by a lack of rain? Are any of you without water in your tap? Are you stopped by a drought from drinking your monster drink or getting your coffee or your tea? No, because we're operating on a different level. We've got a different operating system, a different set of pipes that's feeding us water. And yet, I'm inviting us into a way of thinking about our lives where we're turning to God in a new way, in a powerful way, which brings us back to our psalm. The way that I want to look at this is the last few verses of this psalm, verses 10 and following, describe some characteristics of God, but they're done in a very unusual way. They're like two people are meeting, two singles, and like two people are kissing. It's a fairly unusual metaphor where these four people show up, I'm going to just say like bachelors and bachelorettes. That's how we'll introduce these four characteristics of God. All right, so the first one. This approach to God, these characteristics of God, will also, I hope, help inform our approach to technology. So bachelorette number one is steadfast love. Steadfast love. This is a classic description of who God is. 24/7 available. Unending love. Unfailing. This is a hardworking bachelorette who's committed and flexible, who rolls with the punches of life. Steadfast love that doesn't give up. Bachelorette, and I'm going to number these in order, so that might confuse you. Bachelorette number one meets bachelor number two. And bachelor number two is faithfulness. Faithfulness and steadfast love meet. Faithfulness is loyalty and truth. This guy you can count on, you can depend upon for the just and the true and the right way. It's the opposite of consumer love. He is there for his beloved. Which brings us, those two meet, the next two are gonna kiss. In this next bachelorette, bachelorette number three is righteousness. She is one who acts rightly, who chooses the right path. She is ready to kiss the fourth characteristic, the fourth bachelor that I'll tell you about in just a moment. But she's always walking this path that is the right path. Which brings us to the fourth bachelor. The word peace, shalom, wholeness. Now, wait a second. We already heard that word, didn't we? That was the word we were waiting for. That was the word the priest begged God to say, and they heard peace, shalom, well-being, and it came. I think it's kind of fun, don't you, that these characteristics of God would be like two people meeting or like two people kissing, and yet it goes further. It doesn't just use a relationship metaphor, but it uses an earth and sky metaphor, where the two middle characteristics are treated in this way, where rain from the heavens, righteousness, is hanging up there. And it rains on the ground, and what springs up but faithfulness? So we get this relationship metaphor and also a land metaphor. This is beautiful. You know, I think about Jesus, who prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in heaven and on earth. Do you get the sense that in this relationship with these terms, these characteristics of God, that heaven and earth are being brought together? Earlier I mentioned the land. The psalm mentioned the land. In fact, I'd like you to tuck the land away in your mind and in your heart. We're going to talk about it a bit in this series over the next several weeks. And a lot of times, when you think about land, especially when you're reading the Hebrew Bible, you think about the promised land, right? You think about Israel. You think about this gift of the land to God's people. which is very true. It's accurate. But what often gets lost as we sail bombs back and forth across borders to protect this land, what often gets lost is the land that's meant more metaphorically of our heart. The ground that is the soil of our heart, what gets planted there, what gets watered there, that's where I want us to spend some time, is what we're planting inside of our bodies. Let me ask you a question. If you take your Android phone, your Samsung, your iPhone, and you plant it in your garden, what will happen? Is it going to grow another iPhone? What about if you take a shopping cart, you just kind of borrow one from Target and you dig a big hole and you plant it in the ground? What's going to happen to that shopping cart or to a $100 bill? Nothing. The things that we put in our hearts may have destructive properties to them. They also may have totally infertile and unproductive. That is something for us to consider when we think about Jesus coming and praying for the will of God to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when we see the psalmist singing this psalm and inviting us into these characteristics of God to really begin to operate on a completely different operating system. It's huge. Tuning into God and tuning out to this world is something that we can do regardless of our circumstances. You know, I mentioned old Herlinda. I don't have some great story to follow up with old Herlinda. You've been there before. I lost track of her. I don't know what happened. Sometimes the difficult things that we're going through in our lives, we don't know what will happen for a long, long time. And yet we have the opportunity to do something significant, to plant in our lives seeds that will take root and shape later in our lives. The last verses of this psalm, I'll read the last one. Righteousness will go before him and will make a path for his steps. This is the way I want you to think about this. Think about the direction that your toes point, pointing your toes in a good and right direction, making good choices. In time, you will be able to look back at your heel prints, and you will see that what that has planted is peace. I'm looking and inviting you into a life where distractions, maybe you're more aware of them. The influence of technology, you're more alert to what's going on. To begin to think about how you as a follower of Jesus will make use of your phone, your computer, your internet usage, all forms of streaming, and maybe even press the off button, or at least the reset button, to begin to think about how you do technology. In this passage, we're inviting God to be king, just like Moses was unconcerned about protecting his own leadership. Instead, he was concerned about God and holiness and who he was before God. And in so doing, God took care of things for him. Well, we've covered quite a bit of ground today. We've looked at maybe thinking how we might be silent. Silence in the presence of God so that we could actually hear God. Second, to be able to listen for God's peace being spoken. A peace that comes to us in the action of listening. That really is true. In that action of listening, you're not being inactive. You're on your face with Moses, seeking the face of God. And then, to begin to naturally plant in your life things like righteousness, things like faithfulness and steadfast love, and see if peace doesn't come your way. Today, the way I want to end is maybe in a different way. Usually, I will say a prayer at this point, but I want to offer this line from a guy named Henry Nouwen. Henry Nouwen's no longer living, but he wrote a book called The Inner Voice of Love. And maybe you can see this, maybe not, but I want you to think in terms of powering off and shutting down. So hear these kind of old words in a fresh way. Every time you close another door, think power down, power off. Every time you close another door, be it the door of immediate satisfaction, the door of distracting entertainment, the door of busyness, the door of guilt and worry, or the door of self-rejection. You commit yourself to go deeper into your heart and thus deeper into the heart of God. This is a moment towards full incarnation, of becoming like the God that we follow. It leads you to become what you already are, a child of God, and it lets you embody more and more truth of your being. It makes you claim the God that is within you.